I'd like to call to order Committee of Industrial and Community Development. Originally, this was supposed to be a committee of the whole, but I believe the way it was advertised, this was going to be a regular committee meeting. So on the committee are Councilors Gould, Manning Martin, Councilor McGinn, Councilor Turco, and myself. The first item on the agenda is the proposed zoning amendment for reduction to parking requirements in the BC. And the mayor, would you come forward and just let us know?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Council. I wanted to ask if we could hold this item in committee till the next meeting. I would like just a little additional time to review a couple of cities and some recent changes they've made to their parking before I present. And I think this is an important issue, and I just want to make sure we have all the information necessary. So I'd ask the council just to hold it in committee, and we can maybe meet in a couple weeks or whenever the next meeting would be scheduled.
And a motion from the council? All in favor? Any opposed? It's a vote. Next item on the agenda is the proposed zoning amendment for medical marijuana facilities. And I just wanted to let the council know, somewhere around 4 o'clock, I received an email from a law firm that I distributed. If I could have a motion to receive late communication.
Motion to receive.
All in favor? Any opposed? To vote. And I didn't open it. I didn't check my email for a while. So there's some strong accusations here. And I reached out to the mayor, and he wants to address this. My first take is that, you know, we should get Attorney Smazinski involved to look at this, but I want to hear from the mayor and see what his take on this is. Mr. Mayor.
Good evening, Council. I'd like to make my presentation, and I'd be happy to address that letter. To me, that's a very self-serving letter meant to intimidate us and to try to block us from moving forward with the path that I believe is the correct path. There's a great deal of money to be made in medical marijuana, and it's no doubt there are many companies looking to try to get the necessary licenses and move into cities. This particular attorney is working for a company that has expressed interest in the city, as have many. And I think this is just a blatant, self-serving attempt to try to intimidate us in blocking what I believe is the absolutely 100% right move to make for our city. And I'm going to be moving forward asking for your support regardless of that letter. One thing I've learned, and I think all of you know, attorneys bring lawsuits. That does not mean they are correct. You have two attorneys. One will say one thing. Another attorney will say a completely opposite thing. And that'll have to be determined moving forward. I do not want to be intimidated. I do not want to make votes or decisions based upon a letter from an attorney who admits in the letter that it's self-serving and uses words such as conceivably. To me, that's not a letter that we should pay any mind to and move forward. If there's a challenge, let them make the challenge. But I don't want that to deter us from what I think is doing the proper thing for our community and doing the right thing for the city of Peabody. I'm going to move forward. I'd be happy to answer questions about the letter. It was just presented to me a short time ago. I never received it, and I've never spoken to that attorney. However, I do know that there's interest in the city in different city properties. And the properties are one, and I think we should be the determining factor as to where the medical marijuana facility should go. So with that, I'm going to make my presentation. Be happy to answer any questions. This has become a very important issue to me, and that letter only serves to tell me that we are doing the right thing and that this is the right decision to make for our community. And it only strengthens my resolve to move forward with this decision. I have spoken with Attorney Smazinski, and he feels the same way. Currently, right now, we have an ordinance in the city prohibiting the establishment of a medical marijuana facility. I do not believe that a straight out prohibition would stand up to a legal challenge. And I've also learned a great deal about the operation of these facilities. There is a stark difference between medical marijuana facilities and the sale of retail recreational marijuana. As all of you know, and we had a great discussion on this, and it was terrific. I think all of us were on the same mindset. I am strongly opposed to recreational marijuana being sold within the city of Peabody. And I'm pleased that we as a city council have decided to put that forward to the public to let them vote, let them decide what type of city we want to be, let them decide what type of message we want to send to the youth of our community. There are just numerous questions abound about how recreational marijuana is going to be policed, overseen, how potential abuses are going to be curbed. There's just, to me, it's chaos right now. And this, though, is different than medical marijuana facilities. I recognize that there is a need for medical marijuana for health reasons. I think that there is a need, but it has to be a relationship, I believe, through a doctor. And there has to be oversight through the state. And medical marijuana facility has that. There's a procedure that has to be followed for you to get approved to purchase medical marijuana through a doctor, get an approval from the state, get a state identification card, and that allows you to go forward and purchase medical marijuana. It is not a situation when you can walk in off the street. There is a procedure, there is oversight, and I'm comfortable moving forward with how that would work. Here today, I am proposing the creation of a zone in the city to allow for the establishment of a medical marijuana facility. That zone that I'm proposing is, and I will read the language, is sited east of United States Route 1 and south of the access ramp from United States Route 95/Route 128, south to United States Route 1 south. That is in the BR1 zone. To make it easy for everybody, that is the area from Bertucci's on Route 1 to Don's Hardware. There's Bertucci's, there's Brothers Casino, Don's Hardware, a couple of other establishments. There is a great deal of land behind that, those locations, and I would propose that that be the creation of our medical marijuana zone. I do believe this is the proper thing to do. Certainly it may be challenged. Often our decisions are challenged, but I do believe that this is the right thing for our city to make sure that we protect our city's interests and that we have control over where these medical marijuana facilities go. Based on legal research, based on discussions that we've had with other municipalities, we do not believe that a straight-out prohibition would stand up to a legal challenge, but the creation of a zone, as we have with other type of uses, the creation of a zone is the proper route for us to take to maintain that control as a city. And even more so now with that letter sent to us on the eve of the vote, a very self-serving letter that to me is filled with conceivablys and maybes, to me only strengthens my resolve and strengthens my belief that this is the appropriate action for us to take. If they want to challenge it, let them go forth and challenge it. They have that right to do so. I don't think we as a city should take a step back because of a letter sent to us at the last minute. And again, I think we can get 10 attorneys in a room and we could have 10 different opinions. That attorney is being paid by a medical marijuana company to bring a medical marijuana company to Massachusetts. That's his goal. That's what he's hired to do. That's what he's paid to do. And hence, this is that letter sent to us again to try to intimidate us from doing what I think is the right thing to do. I hope you share that belief with me. I had asked to move forward, not take a step back because of this letter sent to us, and we create this zone going forward. I believe it is the right thing for our community. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Councilors? Questions? Councilor Gravel?
Sorry if I'm smiling, but I just so much enjoyed the attorney comment, especially given your former position. But
I forgot about those things.
I've always believed in that myself. Yeah, you can get 10 attorneys in a room and get 10 different opinions, and none of them will be right. Sorry, Jack. I got cut out on that comment, you know. The, since the the enactment of the state law which allowed medical marijuana. I've had a chance to interact with a number of people who now participate in the program getting the medical marijuana card through a doctor as a prescription, and it's an annualized thing, and it certainly has shaped my opinion on the value of that particular use for those people. I've had a chance to talk to people who've had chronic back pain and who were prescribed opiates, and which to me are so much more harmful. And as a result of getting off opiates and being prescribed medical marijuana, have been able to live a pretty good life in terms of easing of the pain that they suffer every day. Some are friends, some that I've known for many years who have been suffering. And so clearly, I think there's a place for it, and I agree with the mayor. I don't believe that because an attorney tells us that we should be able to put this anywhere. I think we as a elected board have a responsibility to put these types of facilities where we believe they are most appropriately situated, not in neighborhoods and, you know, clearly, because the nature of it is to prescribe, it's a drug that's being prescribed like any other drug that's being prescribed. So I have no fear in terms of this letter, in terms of supporting. I think the location is a good location. I don't think anybody who's using this medically is going to say, well, it's such an inconvenience to go up to Route 1. Because most of them now travel to Salem or to Newton or to other places where they have to, that's the only places that they have that can dispense. And they're more localized than that. So it doesn't trouble me to have a facility of this nature that's well controlled. And by the way, further strengthens our case if we want to, if the people vote against recreational use, if there's an allocation of the number required by city, this replaces part of that number. So I don't really think it's a bad thing, and I think you're absolutely right. We shouldn't let one letter sway an opinion. If you believe that this is good to go forward, you have my support to do that.
Any other councilors? Councilor Gould.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to acknowledge Councilor Gravel's statement. I think he's right on target that if somebody needs it for medical purposes, having it in a particular spot on Route 1 is not going to prevent them from going there. I don't know the amount that is prescribed, whether it's a weekly dose or a monthly dose. But I think that Councilor Gravel is spot on. It's a location that is convenient for folks in the city. Everybody can get to Route 1 regardless of where they live in a matter of minutes. And I think it will work logistically for those folks. So I will support the mayor in this effort. Thank you.
Councilor Manny.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've come around to the benefits as well of medicinal marijuana when it first was proposed. I think it's 4 years ago. I was against it, and I supported the mayor's effort to ban it in the city. And I think everybody has had 4 years to learn that the state is putting the best foot forward to keep the regulations put regulations in place and roll this out the right way. So I'm not adverse to having a facility and zoning an area in the city appropriately, you know, in the right manner in order to do that. But my concerns are just in the Globe yesterday, there's was an article entitled Medical Marijuana in Disarray Amid Pot Uncertainty. And it was a rather lengthy article. And I'm just wondering, would it behoove us to slow down just a little bit? Because the rest of the communities seem to be very concerned, as I share the concerns, of the uncertainty with the medicinal marijuana and the recreational marijuana laws coming into conflict, and the uncertainty of the changes that are soon to be made by the state legislature on the recreational marijuana. So, and I just learned this just yesterday by the article in the Globe, that I mean, there's just so many more questions. Even if we identify an area in the city and zone it for medicinal marijuana, which is what we want to do, I concur with that. There's just so many unknown issues that may come up. In particular, under the recreational law, medical dispensaries that opened or received preliminary approval from the state before December 15th, 2016, are allowed to apply for recreational licenses up to 1 year before the other applicants. Now, what does that mean if we were to zone this area that the mayor's suggesting, and the person who gets it already has been approved by the state prior to December 15th, has received their preliminary approval, they'll be able to sell, will they be able, it says here, that they will be able to sell recreational. So there's one issue I'd like to know the answer for before we move forward on that. And also, there's a lot of talk that the medicinal marijuana facilities are really anticipating and looking forward to selling as well recreational marijuana. And that's pretty much what this whole article is about. They don't want to, and some cities and towns are saying, well, we will allow you to open the medicinal marijuana facility if you agree not to sell recreational. And many of them are not agreeing to that because they're seeing that the law is changing, it's fluid, and why agree to something when you really don't know what you're saying no to? But basically, there's 40,000 patients today that are active medicinal marijuana approved cardholders. So the medicinal marijuana sites would go from having clients from a 40,000 person pool, if recreational passes, to a much, much larger pool, because they'll be able to have two bites at the apple. The other thing that was concerning was, give me 1 second, please. And what is good that we have the ban that we put forward to put it on the ballot to ban recreational. So if the voters agree to ban the recreational in the upcoming referendum, then that won't be an issue if we have a medicinal marijuana, because the voters will say, no, we don't want recreational, and then we would just have the medicinal. But we have to wait to find out what the voters have to say, because if the voters say, yes, we want recreational, then we will have recreational and medicinal in that spot as well. So again, it's just another question out there that we don't have the information because we don't have the vote, we don't have the legislature's change in the recreational law, and I think that there will be many. So I do agree that we need to zone. I do agree I'm all in favor of having the medicinal marijuana zone and welcoming a or more facilities, depending on what we zone for medicinal marijuana. But my concern is that we seem to be rushing it with a lot of information out there that is unknown. So I simply would need more time to get answers to these questions, that there are no answers to the questions, and there's just too many questions. Again, I think we're heading in the right direction, but I need more time, and I would suggest that the council, that we have more time so that we know what the laws are, what we're heading into, because if we zone for something and then all the rules change, we're going to be stuck with whatever the decision makers, who haven't even made the decisions yet, come up with. We're going to say it's okay. And what are we saying okay to? Right now, we don't know. So I'm simply suggesting that we hold back a little bit, a little more time before we make such a zoning change, and get more information so that we know exactly what we're heading into. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. And I think it's one of the proudest moments that I've been a part of. Working with the City Council is our vote to allow the residents of this community to vote on the medical marijuana, or the recreational marijuana issue. I think we absolutely did the right thing. Very proud of that. I respectfully disagree with some of Councilor Manning's points, although I agree with many of her points. Our zoning ordinance is a living, breathing document, and what I mean by that is, there are constant changes made to our zoning ordinance. Every few meetings, we're making a change in some way because we have to adjust to times, adjust to law changes, adjust to just quality of life issues that arise. My feeling is to wait would not be the right course of action. I believe, based on the information we know right now, this is the appropriate step for us to take. Certainly, the election is until November. To wait until we have a vote of the city, no matter which way it goes, is 7-8 months away. To wait that long to make a decision, to wait till we have a vote as to retail recreational, I think would be a mistake. I suggest and I strongly urge to move forward with the creation of the zone. If the law changes 6 months from now, or a year from now, or 2 years from now, we make the adjustments as a community, as a council, to make those adjustments. Just like we did today, what I'm seeking is to change an ordinance that we put on the books some years ago. That was to prohibit medical marijuana facilities. Over time, we've learned more about the law. Over time, we've learned more about medical marijuana, what it means, the comforts, as Councilor Gravel and Councilor Gould articulated, the comforts it gives to ease people's pain. I have softened my stance because I understand that there is a need for medical marijuana. And now I'm coming to you to create a zone because I do think it's unlawful, and I do think it's the right thing to do, to allow residents in this area to have access to medical marijuana. I do believe that this location is the appropriate location for us, balances the needs of those that would want medical marijuana, but also balances the needs of an area that we want to have this facility located. Do we want it near a school? Do we want it near neighborhoods? Absolutely not. That's why I think this location is a prime location for this type of facility. To wait maybe 6 months from now, or maybe 3 months from now, or maybe a year from now, we do get notified of a change. Maybe we learn more. That's when we as a community come back together, discuss it, and make the appropriate changes. Again, to reflect changes in law, changes in public opinion, to adjust to new information. That's why this is a living, breathing document, because we always have that ability to make those changes. I believe, and a strong belief, even more so after this letter and after this attempt to intimidate us, that this is the right form of action for us to take. I strongly request and recommend that we move forward and not wait. Again, changes can be made. If we sit back and wait, who knows what type of submissions will be made.
Councilor Manning.
Thank you. And Mayor, I agree with you, and I never I obviously wasn't clear. I'm not waiting for the vote of the residents in November, because this council acted in a manner to be ready to move forward. If it does pass, we put a moratorium in, I think it was until July 2018, in order to figure out what we're doing. So I'm not saying wait to see how that vote is. I mean, I think that the council has covered both bases in that regard. We're hoping that the voters ban it, which is why we're putting out to them, but if they don't, we have additional time to figure out how to implement it. What I am looking for, so I'm not waiting for the voters, and I'm not saying to wait until November. What I am looking for is guidance from the state. The state needs to get its act together and tell us what to do as communities. We have recreational and medicinal breathing down our throats, and it's a big moneymaker, as the mayor says, and I just want to get this right. So I want more guidance from the state. I'm not waiting for the voters to take action. I think the council, as I said, has covered both the bases, and I'm not concerned about that. What I want to do is do it right, do it the right way, and I just feel that we're rushing a zoning change and zoning amendment. Irrespective of whatever this letter is here this evening, I'm not acting with any regard to that at all. So I just want more information from the state to give us guidance so that we know what we're doing and what we're walking into and what we're exactly zoning for and what we're bringing to the city and how we're going to regulate it. And only the state can really tell us that, and they haven't done it yet. So that's where I'm coming from, Mayor. Thank you.
Councilor Walsh.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. My question has nothing to do with that part of the conversation. Mine is more a technical question on the zone itself. And how many parcels are we talking? You know, do you know how many parcels are in that zone from the split to where it ends?
There's four businesses on that stretch. Bertucci's, Brothers Cucina, there's another commercial building. I just can't think of the name.
The gas station there, 7-Eleven, I believe.
Yeah, I believe you're correct. And then there's Don's Hardware in that area. Behind that, there is several acres of land.
Is that one parcel, Mr. Mayor, through Mr. Chairman, through you? Is that one parcel, or is that owned by several different people? Do you know?
My understanding is it's one parcel.
Thank you.
If the council doesn't mind, if there's any other comments from the council, I have a few. Council McGinn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Through to the mayor, I think what I heard in some of your opening comments, I'm very attentive to Councilor Manning Martin's the points that she raises, but I'm just hearkening back to what you said in some of your opening comments. You feel that as the law exists today, we would not stand up to a legal challenge, correct?
I think to have the outright prohibition that we have on the books right now, I believe it would be very difficult to not have that overturned, and I do not believe it would stand up to a legal challenge.
So just, and can I infer from that that in your opinion, this at least takes care of where we, or addresses the situation as we know it today based on what we know to be existing law, state law? You think that this addresses the notwithstanding the evolution that could take place going forward based on the promulgations of additional regulations relative to medical or recreational use. As it stands today, this is helpful in terms of protecting us from a legal challenge.
I agree. I mean, this is it's a fluid situation. There's challenges all across the country regarding this issue. I was with a city councilor from a community in Western Massachusetts just this past weekend, and I just in conversation asked him what's the biggest issue you're dealing with in your community, and he told me medical marijuana and recreational marijuana, and it's a large community in Western Massachusetts. So this is every city and town is grappling with this, and there are constant lawsuits, there are constant changes to the law. I do believe right now, the way the law stands, that this is the appropriate action. The straight prohibition would not stand up to a legal challenge. I believe the creation of the zone is necessary and is in the best interest of our community.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Any other councilors? If you don't mind, Mr. Mayor, I have a few questions. So how much land is of those parcels? What's the total amount of land back
Several
there?
Acres.
Several acres. So there is no building back there. So if someone wants to come, they're going to put up a building.
It's developable land.
Yeah. It's developable land. Now, these are coming in as nonprofits.
Yes.
So that means they will not be paying any real estate taxes. So has there, I did have some discussions with a facility up in Gloucester, and they actually cultivate. And what they, what this gentleman said to me was, they were actually getting a percentage of the gross of the sales with a minimum, I thought he said, of 100,000 plus. Based it as a minimum, and then if you did 5 million in sales, the city gets $250,000. So now you know why you get letters like this, because there's so much money on the table here. It's greed. And there's what I sense is there's going to be a conflict between recreational and medicinal. And Councilor Manning has a good point. If this is a document we can adjust, can we put in here that this medical facility does not sell recreation? Do we have the power to craft it? Because now you're opening up, I don't even know what the law is on it, but, and then it says they want to be able to sell medical marijuana-infused products, which I can only guess what that is, and I don't know if there's any legislation dealing with that. So, and so if you can just respond to some of those.
We would have the ability for any company that comes in to operate a medical marijuana facility to negotiate a home fee agreement, a host fee agreement, in which there would be, through negotiation, could be done in a number of different ways. It could be a set fee, or it could be a fee and then dependent upon sales. That's something that we'd have to take up. I have my feelings on the appropriate course of action. But that would be two different routes we can go in terms of the host fee agreement, would be to go on a straight flat fee per year or on some sort of percentage, as was outlined to you by that gentleman. Any company that I would look to do business with, it would certainly be clearly just medical marijuana only. And that would have to be negotiated and discussed by any person, any company that's interested in that site.
Okay, because that is, it's a special permit process.
Yes.
So when somebody comes for this, they're going to come to this council requesting a special permit.
Correct.
So I guess my question is this, and it's clear what everybody said about zoning and where we want to put it, where we want to control it. And Route 1, to me, seems like it's the best place, along with our other houses of drinking and methadone clinics and all that type of thing. It kind of fits, I guess, if we're going to throw it up there. And they're not coming into our community. They're not driving into our downtown. They're not going into strip plazas. But the question I ask is, it's clear, and to the point of this, and I don't want to, whether he's right or wrong, but it does seem like this does limit us to one. And when I hear that Salem might have two or three, Lynn's going to have two, what is the right amount? And so my question is, can we say, instead of this, should we be opening up a little further to keep it on Route 1? Say in our zone we're going to allow two clinics, because this is going to be quite a business once it gets up and running. And they're going to be overwhelmed, and there's probably going to be a need for another one. And we've zoned it into this small particular area where there's not another chance for another one. I think that's the gist of this, but I don't know how many buildings we could get in there. They may even expand. Maybe they want to get into cultivation like up in Gloucester. So, you know, and that's the question. Do we want to, I guess, like in any business, do we want competition? No matter what the product is, do we want competition? And should we open it up a little, control it? I'm not saying, you know, open it up to all areas of the city, but keep it on a small section of Route 1 and give somebody else a chance to want to do that. But that's just my thought. Because, and then the other question was, wasn't there a limit in Essex County of how many facilities, and I didn't know if, you know, can we have 10 if we wanted? You know what I'm saying? I don't know what the limit is per community. There's so many questions on this. So can we have as many as we, quote unquote, want within reason?
My understanding is that there are 35 licenses that are given out statewide, distributed equally among the counties.
Okay, so does anybody have the figures of how many are being applied for or how many are available at this point? What are left on the table?
I do not.
Okay. All right. Any,
in the Boston Globe, it says more than 4 years after the voters approved medical marijuana use, only 10 licensed dispensaries are currently selling prescription marijuana products in Massachusetts. There are plenty waiting in the wings. More than 80 dispensaries have cleared initial regulatory checks and locked up locations around the state. So there are 80 dispensaries, they're saying, that have cleared regulatory checks and locked up locations. They already have sites.
So I would think at some point the state's going to increase that amount allowable. There's only 35 statewide.
Yes, and those for licenses.
And there's 80 applying, as we know, as that article says. Yeah. It'll be opened up, be more.
So the mayor's pointing out this difference between licenses and facilities, maybe? Is that 10 licensed dispensaries and 80 dispensaries have cleared the regulatory checks and locked up locations. So I don't know if there's licenses or dispensaries are different or... Or you can have a license and have several dispensaries. I don't know.
You know what? I don't know the answer. And I guess the last one is the vetting process for these companies. Because how are we going to look at these companies that are coming in? And if we're going to have one, then there should be some major competition and a fight for that one. And as a host, you know, are those negotiations with you in the company, or is that negotiations on the floor of the council on the host fees and what the fees are?
So 35 licenses are available. Right now, as Councilor Manning-Martin said, 10 are taken. There are a number of companies that are pursuing those licenses, and they're going through the vetting process. And I think that's what needs to be shown, is that they have a site, that they're qualified, and then ultimately they would apply for those licenses. Just like any sort of license, you know, we have limits on the licenses that we offer, liquor licenses being chief among them. But that's what's going through. This is the vetting process in order to get those licenses. Right now, I know, of course, there's been one operating in Salem for a significant period of time. I believe there's also one operating in Revere that I know of. But certainly, they're going to be coming to Essex County. And that's why I think this action is appropriate for us to carve out the location in Peabody where this type of facility could go.
So just to make it clear, so I'm very concerned with what Councilor Manning said about the medical selling recreational. So when we start vetting these companies, when it's on the table to negotiate, the attitude here is we do not want recreational being sold out of this, and then they can either say, yeah, we're in, no, we'll just do medical, or no, we're going to sue you because the ordinance of the state. Is what's your take on that?
We have a moratorium right now. We also have made the motion to put it to a referendum to have the city vote. If the city votes how we all hope, then recreational will not be allowed in the city limits. And that would have to be part of any license that would go forward here or any agreement that would go forward in the city.
Okay, thank you, Mayor. Councilor Sasla?
And to follow up on that train of thought, if the city votes to allow recreational marijuana, at that point, does that company that would operate at this particular parcel of land, would they automatically then be in the business of recreational? And have we lost our opportunity to negotiate further hosting for your taxes?
I think that could be part of an agreement. If there was an agreement negotiated before the vote was taken, I think to protect the city's interest, we would have to include language in the agreement to account for that instance. We don't know. If it's voted down, if it's approved in the city, in the vote, to allow for recreational retail marijuana, I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know where stores will open up. That's why I think this is a critical vote. I know that I will be campaigning extremely hard on this issue, and I think many of you also will be. And I think this is an important vote for the future of our city.
And my only other concern is I don't know from a, I'm not a lawyer, but you know, when we look at what you're proposing, Mr. Mayor, for the zoning area, I don't have an issue with it. My concern is if there is some type of litigation where they can say that we zone such a small piece of property, have we really not opened up the process fairly? And I'm okay going forward with it, but I just want to express to the public that that is a concern of mine, that we, you know, there are four buildings there, so maybe Don's Hardware can realize, you know what, I'm going to sell out because now my property went up, just like people who own property across from the Wynn Casino. That's their opportunity to sell out and cash in, and that's America. But I don't know if they would do that. We don't know that. There are so many unknowns, but I did think to a degree that maybe there might be a piece of property, a small area southbound. I don't ask you to detain that tonight. I understand where you stand on it, but it is somewhat of a concern that for the reasons I expressed, that where we have such a limited area, are we opening us up to some things that could be possible litigation because of that? But I think you've basically stated tonight you're willing to, you know, take a chance on that, and I respect that.
Yeah. I do believe that this is the appropriate action, the legally, that we would meet legal standards, but certainly it could be challenged. You know, that and any ordinance or any decision we make on a motion certainly can be challenged, and those are rights afforded to people. However, I do believe that this is I believe this is the appropriate step for us.
Just to follow up what Councilor Sasaw said, those properties that are going to abut it, those aren't zoned for clinics, only the property behind it. So I'm just, if Petucci's wanted to sell, they can't put an additional facility there. It's just the land behind it. Or does it include those properties?
It would include all of that, all of the properties.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Councilor Gravel?
Yeah, it does say, in the general law, it does say that there are only 35 licenses statewide. But there's no specified limit as to the number of those licenses that a city can apply for. That a city can apply for. So in other words, a city could apply for multiple, you know, you could have multiple licenses in a city, but at state level, there's no more than 35.
Oh, I was right for once. The mayor said that those properties are not in the medical marijuana district. So, is that correct, Mayor?
Yes. You've been right a few times, Barry.
I'm sorry, so it's just one? Those properties are not in the zone? It's just that one area?
It's the land behind it. It's that one little triangle. It's 4 acres, I think. It's a few acres of land.
Sounds like spot zoning to pick one area. I thought it was the whole area with all those businesses already there. Is that, I think we're on a slippery slope. It sounds like spot zoning.
I completely disagree.
Council McGinn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think it's the city clerk that's making that determination based on looking at the map, is that right? Because I think the language of the proposed ordinance would indicate it is the broader area that the mayor is describing, 6.13.4. So medical marijuana treatment center, registered marijuana dispensary, RMD, and off-site medical marijuana dispensary, OMMD, in BR1, that is sited east of US Route 1 and south of the access ramp from Route 95 / Route 128 south to Route 1 south.
That is the proposed district, that language.
That is the language, and I think that includes the multiple parcels that you had described, Mayor, as I'm looking at that.
That the triangled parcel that's in the in your packet, that is the area right now that is the separate ownership of that.
Correct. I think what happens
so
is
it
when
is the, it is. I'd have to look at the map. That's a property line, so it is the whole area.
The whole area, Mr. Chairman, through you to the mayor, the whole area that includes.
As I look closely at it, that's just a triangled lot that's parceled off to show a
that's within the
property
area.
Division, exactly within that.
Correct.
But it
right.
is the whole stretch, as defined by, in a BR1 zone that is sited east of US Route 1 and south of the access ramp from US Route 95 / Route 128. South to US Route 1 South, and that's that area.
So, when this goes to a public hearing, we're going to have to notify all those businesses that,
like any special permit
that, that they would yep. were changing their zoning.
So, through the chair, I'm sorry. It seems as though we've said two different things, and I don't think I'm up to speed. So, it's more than just one lot. It's several businesses in that are in this triangle. That's
indicated. What I'm understanding right now.
Because we've said two different things.
Councilman
because if
Gant.
That's the case, it's not spot zoning. If it's just one owned piece of property, it's spot zoning. So we've said two different things. So I just didn't want to use the term spot zoning if it is inaccurate, because if you're telling me that it's the whole strip with several different residences, that's different to my response to Council Sinowitz, who had indicated otherwise, correct? All
yeah.
right, thank you.
Right.
I'd like to correct myself, because Council Manning Martin is right. When I looked, I just saw the triangle. It is a triangle area, but it's a triangle area of all those properties, not just a triangle area of the developable land that's noted. So her comment about spot zoning in my response to that was incorrect as well.
So
it is that whole triangle area listed, including those locations.
And then we need to immediately update the maps, that's going to have to be updated before we move forward any hearings.
It essentially acts as an overlay district, just like other zones that we've created, and I think everybody knows the zones that we've created in the city. This acts as similar as an overlay district.
Council McGinn.
I think the mayor offered up the clarification that I was going to, so I think we're all set. And I just add that it's the language that matters, not the draft map that we have. So I think we have in front of us an accurate description of the area that's proposed for change. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Gravel.
Yeah, while perusing through this law, here's an interesting tidbit that I didn't know that may color your thought process in making a decision. There's a section of the law called home cultivation, and it says the eligibility, the regulations allow for home cultivation, also known as hardship cultivation, when a qualifying patient, somebody who has a card, meets at least one of three criteria. One, they verify that they have a financial hardship. Two, that they have a physical incapacity to access reasonable transportation. And three, that there's a lack of an RMD, which is a registered marijuana dispensary, within a reasonable distance from their home. So it's interesting that the absence of a dispensary could result in people being, with hardship, able to cultivate within their home. Just thought I'd add a little flavor.
Well, you know, we could, we all could debate, and we have different opinions on those different issues, and I certainly do, but I'm not going to let them know right now. But any other comments from the council? We have a motion. Councilor McGinn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd move to refer to the planning board the language put forward by His Honor the Mayor in the Mayor's November 10th, 2016 communication to the City Council, the City of Peabody, regarding changes to the zoning ordinance regarding medical marijuana facilities. So moved.
On the motion, roll call vote.
Councilors Manning Martin.
No.
Turco.
Yes.
Gould.
Yes.
McGinn.
Yes.
Sinowitz.
Yes.
Motion carries 4-1.
Thank you, Council.
Next item on the agenda, billboard moratorium. I believe Councilor Walsh, was that, did you make that motion?
I did, Mr. Chairman. I'm not a member of the committee, but I did refer this to you. This is an issue that a couple years ago, as you know, the council decided to extend the moratorium on new applications for billboards. And my concern is that we need to get working on this now to decide what our ultimate policy is going to be. My preference would be that we have a permanent moratorium on it, but that's for the committee to decide. And if we are, I think the one thing that needs to be considered is the new technology and the existing billboards, how that would impact us over the course of the next several years. So when we're looking at it, not only I think we need to consider the moratorium on new applications, but how it affects the existing ones that we have.
Councilors, we do have the building inspector here. Al, could you come forward?
I apologize. I wasn't paying attention to the question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The discussion is a moratorium on billboards, and what the policy of the council and the city will be moving forward. We have a moratorium that is good for another year. But the other part of that is, with the existing billboards today, is there any language that we should be including as well, given that technology changes and we don't want to get caught with existing billboards perhaps having a second frame or whatever you want to call it. We just want to make sure that if we are moving to a permanent moratorium, that we are within our rights with the existing billboards.
I think the only exception that I don't have the zoning ordinance right in front of me, but digital display is the only new technology that I'm aware of as far as billboards. That's what's basically all of them are moving forward towards that medium.
Okay, thank you. I guess, Mr. Chairman, my recommendation would be that we make the moratorium permanent, and then as time goes on, just like we had that discussion in the last topic, that if we have to adapt, we do. But my concern is that we make sure that it is clear that the city no longer will entertain new permit applications for our billboards.
Any other councils? Al, I have a question for you. Come on back. When the whole billboard scenario was created, there was a lot, not as bad as the marijuana and the laws, but we didn't know what the actual rules were. There was supposed to be, what, 500 feet from a static, 1,000, but it wasn't linear. It couldn't be south, north, whatever. So how many possible billboards, based on how we zoned it, could fit on Route 1? Meaning, what's eligible with that 1,000 feet from width 1? How many more could somebody apply for? Do you know what that answer is? Or do you have to look at a map? I think that if the council knows what I'm getting at, there's only so many per feet on north and south. And I didn't know if there is space for any more. You know, I don't know. There's plenty of space for lawsuits, right, when we say this, but so you don't know?
If you're asking about, like, expanding a structure, what the setbacks are, or, I mean, it all depends on the engineering. If that's a question, whether something can be expanded where you can have multiple of them on one parcel or several feet away from each other, I believe that you can have as many as you want, as long as is the setbacks are set, you know, on our zoning. If it says it's going to be one on one parcel, then that's the way it is. But as far as structurally, if an engineer proposes one, you know, 50 feet away from the other one, I really see no issue on that.
Yeah, there's ordinances. I don't know if it is. Let's go to Council Sasso.
My gut tells me that they're probably, if you laid out Route 1 based upon the existing ordinance, whether it be 500 feet for a static or 1,000 feet for a digital, there might be a chance to squeeze one or two in, but that's not my concern. Following up on Council Walsh, I didn't know where you're going, and I'm still not 100% sure, but I'll give an example. If you're coming out of Boston on Saugus and Cappies, you see these billboards that are, I would say, a double billboard. It's a small one, it's a tall one. So I fall in line with Councilor Walsh. What I'd like to ask maybe is, knowing that the intent, Al, is the council does want to go through with a permanent moratorium, I think what we're trying to do is cross our T's and dot our I's and make sure that we don't put ourselves in a precarious situation. So I think the will of the council is we'd like to go through the moratorium. Maybe you can go back and, knowing that, do some due diligence, see if there's anything structurally that we don't have in our ordinance that should be. I don't even, quite frankly, understand the double billboards. I assume that we couldn't do it now, but I could be wrong. I don't even know if our ordinance would allow a double billboard on one pole. Maybe you can look into that. But knowing that, I don't want to speak for the council, but I do feel there is a will that we have exhausted the billboards. We would like to move on, and we don't want to revisit every 2 years of the moratorium. So I am in the same sense of Council Walsh. I'd like to kind of get that language out there, tighten it up, and let's just get it done. So maybe you can go back, and we'll keep this in the subcommittee, knowing that we want it to come up and to get the language.
Council Walsh.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Through you to Council Sasla, that's precisely my point. I'm hoping it is the will of the council that we make the moratorium permanent, but that's exactly right with technology. And you know, if somebody comes back and says, well, you've already given me a permit, but we want to add another screen, that's a concern. I just want to make sure that however we word our ordinance, that we prohibit that. Yeah. So he's right. Thank you.
All right, so we'll leave in committee as...
Right, but we need some help in crafting the language to reach that goal.
Can we get a motion from one of the council again to the building inspector?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yeah, I would move that we request from the city solicitor proposed language to make permanent the moratorium on billboards, and that language specifically address the addition of additional screens to existing billboards. So moved.
On the motion, Council Manning.
Yes, I had raised that issue as well, and now that we're talking to linking it to a moratorium, absolutely 100% moratorium, no more. I think you know, everyone knows my feelings on the billboards. But we may want to get a legal opinion on altering the structure and not link it to the moratorium. Meaning, because I think we had discussions before, and I can't recollect, about making the moratorium permanent. And we got a legal advice that must have told us that we couldn't do it. So I think something happened, Tom, and I don't remember, because we wanted to say we don't want any more, and we would have done that. So I think we need a legal advice on it, but also a legal advice on two separate issues. Yes, we want a moratorium, but what's more concerning for me now is that if the billboard companies hear that the moratorium is becoming permanent, they may say, well, let's do those double billboards now. Let's alter the structure now, so that, because we could probably get away with it now, given the language of our special permit. So what's more concerning for me is to talk to legal and the building commissioner to look at those as two separate issues, because I don't want them to sneak it in while they're waiting for the moratorium, that it's within their special permit language that we better do it now. Because they did that to us when they went from static to digital. Because we gave them permission for the static, and they flipped it to a digital. So they may start to do the double billboard thing on us because it's on the special permit. So I don't know. So I think we should probably get a legal opinion and keep the two matters separate.
You want to make that in a form, Council?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I think that I thought the questions were pretty much that anyway. We're asking for language, what language would look like. We're not making any decisions tonight, but what we're suggesting is this is the direction that we want to go, that we want a moratorium and that we don't want double screens. So if you want it as two separate opinions, I think in the end it's going to ultimately be one piece of language, one body of language. But
yes, but I just don't think see that a moratorium might take too much time. If we want to identify the language that we have now, if we can restrict that and get ahead of the game, that's all I'm suggesting. Because if we wait for the moratorium and it all to come at once, I think they'll get the jump on us. Thank you.
That's a point well taken, Mr. Chairman. I have no objection to that. Of course, I'm not part of the committee, but if you decided that we adopt language or draft language and adopt a moratorium, permanent moratorium, and then look at the other issue separately, I have no objection to that.
Yeah, I think we move forward to working with the building inspector. When that time comes, we submit it to the building inspector. But Councilor Manning has a good point, and I don't want to relive that meeting that we had in executive session, how the building inspector arbitrarily approved a change from a static to a digital billboard. So I don't want to relive that mess. And that was, so when I hear that makes me nervous that, you know, we have a moratorium, and then they go to the building inspector, and the building inspector says, yeah, put up a double face. You know, so that's the concern. And I know Al's standing right there. But
No. We do have a section of the ordinance which specifies that any digital billboards have to come by special permit right now on the books. So there is that piece to it.
Okay. So
would you happen to know if, I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, if there's language in there that's vague enough that they could alter it and just slap up another panel? Because that's a safety issue, it'll cast a shadow, it'll block drivers, it's a whole different animal.
I mean, I'd have to look at all the ordinances and come up with some sort of answer on that one. But as far as what we have now, as far as a static, a regular billboard, any alterations to that to turn it into a digital would need to come in front of the council, or any addition to the other side that would be digital.
Okay, Councilor McGinn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I'd be happy to withdraw that motion and offer two separate motions. First motion would be to request from the city solicitor proposed language to the zoning ordinance to make permanent the billboard moratorium. So moved.
On the motion, all in favor? Any opposed? It's a vote.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And the second motion would be to request from the city solicitor an opinion regarding the prevention of additional screens on existing billboards. So moved.
On the motion?
On existing billboards and related structures. So moved.
Councilman McGinn, can you repeat that one more time?
Move to request from the city solicitor an opinion on means of preventing additional screens on existing billboards and related structures. So moved.
Or alterations.
Or alterations.
Excellent. Thank you.
So moved.
On the motion, comments? All in favor? Any opposed? It's a vote. Last on the agenda is construction hours of operation. Councilor Turco.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. I've been very quiet this meeting, so I was looking forward to talking about hours of operation. I did speak to Commissioner Tallarico, and he helped me put together something that we could both agree upon. The purpose of this discussion is to have one set group of hours of operations in the city ordinance rather than several set forth by several different boards. And this, I'm sure you've heard this story a couple times, but this all came to a head when Council Manning and I took a ride through Ward 1 on Martin Luther King Day, and we really didn't have an answer for the residents. And there were a couple of different locations where construction was going on, and we just thought Council Manning earlier recommended that the permits be put online so that we could check those, and I think this would be a second part of that, to have the set operation, set hours of construction in the ordinance. So what I've looked at, and through discussion with Al Tallarico, was Monday through Friday, 7 a.m. to 6 p.m., Saturday hours from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m., no Sunday or holiday hours, and by holiday hours, I would say we'd go by the federal holidays, and I believe there's 11 of them. And the Sunday and holiday hours would be at the discretion of the building commissioner. And the reason I put that in there is due to earlier conversation with Representative Councilor Walsh and his concern that homeowners wouldn't be able to do small work around the house. And through discussion with Al, by leaving that discretion to him, he could approve those permits. And to take it one step further, if and when he does approve a Saturday permit, I'd like to see that there's notification given to the ward counselor on that. And lastly, before I finish and let the rest of this committee speak, rock crushing is also a major issue. Right now in Ward 1, we have several rock crushing areas going on. And what I'd like to put in there is rock crushing in residential areas by special permit only, which is done by several communities. This, it would come before the council for a rock crushing permit if it was in a residential zone, and then we could set those hours. I've looked at a few, some restricted to no more than 6 hours in a day, no more than 3 days per week in order to alleviate the headache to the residents. So if anybody else would like to add to that or make any changes to that, I'm more than open. This is just something that we came up with in a brief conversation.
Any councils? Councilor Walsh.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just through you to Councilor Turco. I just want to thank you for that consideration. That was my concern all along, as we had a discussion earlier, sometime last year, I believe, on setting the hours of operation for construction projects. And it was my concern that the homeowner who works Monday through Friday, 9 to 5 or whatever, sometimes longer, and was doing their own home improvements during the weekend, they should be allowed on a Sunday if they're replacing windows or whatnot. So if the building commissioner has some discretion and some leeway on that, I think that's the right way to go. And also, it's prohibiting any commercial construction going on, and I think that's important. I have no problem with that part of it, as long as we have some leeway so that we're not telling everybody the only day you can do work on your house is Saturday. I think that's the right way to go.
I would just, can I, if I just weigh in, I don't think Councilor Turco, what he's saying, really relates to homeowners, per se. I mean, I'm not going to put any restriction on a homeowner. What I'm talking about is subdivisions. More of that. So I don't think there should be any restrictions of a guy working at home on a Sunday wants to replace a window roof. I don't think that should be in the zoning at all. What I'm talking about and how we classify it, commercial's different. If you're in a commercial zone, that's different. But we're talking about Birch Street, and they're going to put in 23 homes. I'm not, right. Well, it's commercial located in a residential zone. So I'm talking commercial in a commercial zone, commercial in a residential zone, okay? And those hours of operation, Monday through Friday, I don't have a problem with. Was it 7 to 6? Is that what you said, John? I'm concerned about Saturdays in terms of what type of hours and outdoor construction. Like when we went by up in Solomini's, we were there on a holiday, and some people were working inside and some were working outside. So, I mean, I'm not sure how to classify it, but there's no way we would ever restrict a homeowner from doing any type of work on their own home. That's ridiculous. But I think that we got all these, we got 60 more homes at Solomini. We're gonna have a 40B down on Oak Street. We got 23 houses building in Birch Street, on Birch Street. So, you know, and it's just, I don't wanna beat a dead horse, but just protecting the quality of life. And the rock crushing, there should be no rock crushing on a Saturday. And I like the idea about the special permit, because what happens is when you go to the planning board, they don't kind of take all this into effect unless you come up with an order of conditions. And that could be a really drawn out process, but I find the rock crushing is a real issue. So I would say, you know, rock crushing, I don't even know if we should allow it on a weekend, John.
Mr. Chairman, in no way did I say that any hours, I just said rock crushing by special permit only, which we could address at the special permit hearing on a case-by-case basis. So I didn't set any in that section. The hours of construction prior to that were in reference to just construction, not rock crushing. So it would be a separate entry into the ordinance.
Councilor Walsh?
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Chairman. Just a quick question. So is the request from the committee again going to be for a submission of language, are you voting on language tonight? Because there's still, I'd like to see, I think the intent is right, but I'd really like to see it before the council takes a complete vote on it.
Could the building inspector come up? Yeah, I'd like to get your take on this.
I think Councilor Turco is right on as far as the Monday through Friday and Saturday too. Typically, any city or town has worked through those days. Sundays and holidays is typically a special permit or some sort of, special permission through the building inspector's office. So I think it's a good balance between at least having, you know, discretion on my end for Sundays and holidays, and again, we're trying to accommodate the homeowner that's trying to do windows on a Sunday instead of going down there and stopping the job, in comparison to a large-scale addition that is going to disrupt the quality of living around the area.
Through you to Mr. Chairman, through you to Commissioner Tallarico. So while you and I spoke, and I understand, Councilor Walsh, that you'd like to see the actual written ordinance, is it something that we can just take these and, I mean, I have it here. I mean, I could just put it under Section 15 and create Section 15.2.2 and add hours of operation for construction.
If it's a zoning, if this is a zoning change, it's got to go to the planning board, and then we'd have to have a public hearing. So maybe, John, what we should look at, I want to move on this quick. I don't, because there's a lot of projects still pending and coming, but I think we need a little more time. I'm not saying a long time, maybe a few weeks, just to iron out and then come back with precise wording on this. And I'd be glad to. Council Walsh?
Yeah, thanks. The commissioner had his recommendation last year, and I think most of that language is still available. And I think just a minor tweaking of a couple of those suggestions would satisfy anything that we're discussing tonight. So, you know, maybe if you could have a meeting in the next couple of weeks, I think we could finalize that. If you're willing to do that, I think that's the way to go.
Through you to Council Walsh. No, I have no issue with that. We can, Al and I can work together and put together the exact wording of it and then present it at the next meeting.
Okay. That's not an issue. Leave it in committee and we'll during motions orders, we'll move to set up another meeting.
Thank you.
And I think that finishes up. I just want to say a few words. You know, I've been on the council for 10 years now, and I've seen a lot of different things come and go, and I've always tried to really look at things as, you know, in looking out for residents, protecting residents, not as I'm the hero or the resident, but, you know, what's right. And I really believe that people have a right to develop their property, but not at the expense of everybody around them. So I've been doing this for 10 years, and so I think it's time that I'm going not going to run for re-election this year. And I'm just, I'm tired, and we need some new blood. And I hope that whoever replaces me will take that same zest in working, you know, for the residents in the city. I think that when I got elected, I was elected to serve, and I almost feel like now I'm elected, I'm protecting. That's how I feel. So when I feel that way, I think it's time to go. So I hope, I wish everybody the best, and whoever takes my place, good luck. Thank you.
Motion to adjourn.